Hello everyone, this is Prajakta. We welcome you all to the second part of our webinar series on orthotics and prosthetics. Last time we have gone through the overview of orthotics and prosthetics. This time we are going more into details of our lower limb orthotics. I welcome our respected speaker, Dr. Bhakti Damdare ma'am, to enlighten us with her field of expertise. Welcome ma'am, and over to you.
Thank you. Thank you. So, hello everyone. Today, we'll see lower limb orthosis in depth. So, in last lecture, we covered the overview of orthosis, where we actually saw the different types of orthosis, the goals of prescription, and the considerations we have to take while prescribing it. Today, we'll see lower limb orthosis and the different types of lower limb orthosis and their assessment and prescription criteria. So, as we saw last time, that the lower limb orthosis, it can be used to improve the lower limb alignment. It can either assist or restrict the movement, and it can help to prevent or correct the deformity and improve the efficiency and function of the patient. Now, with respect to patient and their impairments, whether it is neurological or musculoskeletal, we need to define the prescription properly, which needs thorough assessment of the patient and the examination. So, grossly, the types of lower limb orthosis are foot orthosis, ankle foot orthosis, knee orthosis, knee ankle foot orthosis, hip knee ankle foot orthosis, and hip orthosis. We'll be covering each one of these and their subtypes in today's module. So, foot orthosis is the most crucial type of orthosis, as it is the foundation of our body. It is the first biomechanical contact point of the human body, and that is the reason it is the most crucial type of orthosis. So it helps to correct the problems of the foot, knee, hip, and spine together. So which means that if there are problems in the alignment of the foot, we should make sure that we should know that it would directly or indirectly affect the knee, hip, and the spine, or vice versa. If there are problems in the knee, hip, or spine, we should always take into consideration to assess the foot properly. So it requires a specific type of assessment, which is the foot analysis. So in commonly clinical practice, we see either a flat foot or a normal foot or a high arch foot. Where flat foot, we can have mild pronation to moderate pronation, or there can be excessive pronation with the navicular drop. Even same goes with the high arch foot. So for assessment, the first thing important is the foot examination. In foot examination, we not only cover just the foot, but also knee, hip, ankle, and the spine. So thorough examination of foot, hip, knee, ankle is important. So in that, we have to check for the position of the heel, the position of the subtalar joint, the we start the gait analysis. Gait analysis just can be a normal two-directional gait analysis, which is also fine. The next is the foot pressure scanning. So foot pressure scanning involves the manual scan as well and the digital scan. For manual scan, the most popularly used method is the Harris-Mack method, which you can see in the first diagram. So this is nothing but a simple ink pad where we take the foot impression of the patient, and in this manner, we get the result out of it. So here, more the number of ink boxes, more is the pressure. Also, if this is the portion of the heel, less than 50% would be the arch portion. And on that basis, we can decide whether it is a normal foot, a flat foot, or a high arch foot. This same scan can be converted into a digital scan using the specific softwares. So this is a way a manual scan can be done. The digital scan can be taken either static or it can be also a dynamic. I would personally advise to take static as well as dynamic scan. So that gives us a report like this, whether it is a well-balanced foot, whether it has mild pronation, moderate pronation, or severe pronation. It also gives weight distribution on both the feet, whether it is equal, not equal, or whether one foot's alignment is different with another foot. So all this can be assessed using the digital scan. In dynamic foot scan, we can actually see each phase of the gait cycle, how the foot is landing, how is the swing phase and the stance phase. The another form of scan is a foam block scan. I normally prefer using this scan in cases of severely deformed foot, like in diabetes or in arthritic, where we have a foam block available and we take the impression of the foot on this foam block. It is then filled with plaster of Paris. The mold is prepared and then it is corrected the custom sole, any foot orthosis for the patient. So on the basis of our foot assessment, orthotic insoles can be to the patient. Now, orthotic insoles are something different than the off-shelf insoles because these are tailor-made insoles which are specifically designed for the patient with a certain alignment. So it would be customized to the alignment of that foot. So it is important in which patients, the patients who are suffering from diabetes, severe arthritis, or other musculoskeletal conditions where you feel that the normal off-the-shelf insoles would not be beneficial and you need to go something better than the normal ones. So in this, a complete insole can be prescribed, either a half insole depending upon the correction we need, or just the heel cup or even the foot plate. So a few types of orthotic insoles are just the medial arch can be given depending upon the requirement of the patient. As I told you, half insole can be given or just the heel cup. Complete insole, which involves the medial arch, heel cup, including the metatarsal pad for depressurizing the areas, or in severe deformed foot, especially in kids who have planovalgoid foot or there is navicular drop or in severe arthritis, a foot plate can be given, which is a little higher version of the insole, but it is somewhat lesser than what an supramalleolar orthosis is. So it has a medial and the lateral wedge and a cup made in between, which holds the heel in proper place. The other type of specific insoles involve the diabetic insoles and the diabetic shoe. So this insole, which you can see in the image, is called as peg assist. So it facilitates the removal of pegs wherever there are insoles or cones available. So it is very helpful in the cases of diabetes where if we have particular area which has ulcer or cone, it can be offloaded or deloaded. So when the patient is weight bearing, that pressure, that area doesn't bear the excess pressure. These peg assist insoles can be incorporated in a special type of shoe which is called as a diabetic shoe. Also, we can see specific form of insoles which can be designed, which can have a metatarsal pad. It can either have a heel wedging. Heel wedging is required if we need a particular alignment of the heel, whether it is in inversion, eversion, or in neutral position. You can see this area, which is called as the offloading area. So if the patient is having metatarsalgia or if there is an excessive pressure over the metatarsal area, which you feel should be corrected through your foot scan. So these areas can also be offloaded in a particular insole. All this is possible with the orthotic insoles depending upon the requirement of the patients. So other foot inserts are a metatarsal pad or a metatarsal bar, which can simply be used in cases of metatarsalgia, the metatarsal pad, the heel cup in case of plantar fasciitis, and even the silicone digital caps can be used for the toes where you feel that there are ulcers present, or you need to add extra cushioning to the toes. The other splints and the braces available are the foot abduction brace. So it is most popularly called as the Steenbeck brace, a DB splint, or a Dennis Brown splint. So it is used in patients or kids with CTEV. So post-poncitic casting, CTEV patients are given the Dobbs splint or the Steenbeck splint to keep the foot in the abduction and hold it. So this is to be worn by kids for at least 22 to 23 hours. The other lower limb supports could be the ankle support or just the ankle binder, which we all have popularly seen used in ankle sprains or strains. Others are the finger splints or the toe splints, like the hallux valgus splints, to be used in the bunion deformity. Just 1 minute. Okay. The another form is the ankle foot orthosis, where we have supramalleolar orthosis, ankle foot orthosis, floor reaction orthosis, which is also called as FRO, patella tendon bearing orthosis, which is also called as PTB AFO, and the immobilizing AFO. So supramalleolar orthosis is orthosis which holds the ankle just above the level of malleoli. It is specially prescribed in the cases of planovalgoid foot, the flexible flat foot or a dynamic flat foot in kids. It can either be in socket, like it can have an extra small SMO inside with an outer SMO to give more rigid support. So it is specifically designed to keep the heel and the ankle in neutral position to support the flat foot in the kids. The next type is the ankle foot orthosis. Ankle foot orthosis can be static or dynamic. It can have the inner shoe, which is called as the in-socket AFO, and it can be without the shoe as well. So it tends to control the ankle, the arches of the foot. So, and helps in giving more specific and a good form of gait in the kids or the patients who have weak lower limb muscles, or to create or to correct the deformities. The goal of the AFO is to stabilize the foot and ankle, and it helps in clearance during the swing phase of the gait. It is used in various musculoskeletal and the neurological conditions such as cerebral palsy, even with lower limb paraparesis. The types of AFO are the static AFO, as I told you, dynamic AFO, leaf splint AFO, or a carbon AFO, which is an energy restoring AFO. The difference between the static and the dynamic AFO is about the ankle joint. So if we have a dynamic AFO, means it will have the ankle joint, which will give you certain degrees of ankle range of motion. And if it is static, it will not give you any ankle range of motion. So depending upon the impairment of the patient and the outcome we want to achieve, the prescription should be given accordingly, that whether we need a static AFO or a dynamic AFO. Leaf splint AFO is given in foot drop cases. It helps in assisting the dorsiflexion and the dragging of the foot. Floor reaction orthosis, it is mostly used in the cases of cerebral palsy, traumatic brain injury, spinal cord, and post-polio paralysis, or even in PPRP. So how it is different than a normal AFO is it has an anterior knee component. So during the mid-stance, when there is heel strike, it pushes the knee behind. So you get the knee extension, which ideally you would not get because either of the weakness of the lower limb muscles or because of the spasticity. So the main function of the FRO is to accentuate the knee extension in mid stance. Next is patella tendon bearing AFO. which is also called as a PTB-AFO. This is most commonly prescribed in the cases of ankle fusion, severe ankle fractures or calcaneal fractures, AVN of foot on ankle. So this is different from a normal AFO because this will offload the ankle and foot and put the entire pressure on patellar tendon and thus give an efficient gait pattern. It can either be made only with the posterior shell or it can have anteroposterior shell, which is also called as an AP shell. Immobilizing AFO, this we all have very commonly seen, these are also called as air cast. These are prescribed in severe ankle sprains or strains or post cast removal for immobilization and as a prophylactic management. Now we'll start knee orthosis. So the goal of knee orthosis is to provide knee stability, prevent knee hyperextension, control the biomechanical alignment of the knee and thus enhance the locomotion, resist the external forces on the knee, limit excessive movements in the knee, act as a shock absorbent and produce more energy efficient gait pattern. So there are multiple types of knee braces available, but I have tried to incorporate the ones which are maximum used in our practice. So first is the range of motion knee brace, knee immobilization brace, patellar stabilizer, genu recurvatum brace, unloader knee brace for osteoarthritis, and stabilizing ligament knee brace. So a knee ROM brace, knee ROM brace can be a full length brace or it can also be a short brace. It comes with a dial lock mechanism. This dial lock mechanism helps us to restrict certain degrees of flexion at the knee joint, and it is most popularly used post operatively to limit certain amount of knee extension or flexion. It is available in multiple types depending upon the requirement of the patient. Knee immobilization brace, it helps to restrict the movement at the knee. It can come with the hinges or without the hinges. It is most commonly used for immobilization post-operatively and it helps in the early phases of rehab. Next is this patella stabilizer brace. So patella stabilizer brace can just come into a strap, which is also called as a Chopard strap, or it can come with an actual hinge knee brace with the patellar strap. So it helps to relieve the pain which is arising because of the instability of patella or patellar subluxation and helps the tracking of the patella with this additional strap called as a C-shaped buttress strap. Next is the genu recurvatum brace. It helps to prevent the hyperextension at the knee joint. It could arise from various conditions such as ligament instability as a result of any neurological impairment. So a specific brace with a posterior band is given to prevent the posterior translation of the knee and thus prevent the hyperextension of the knee. It is useful mainly for ligament laxity or other instability conditions in the knee. Knee unloader brace. Knee unloader brace is also known as the knee offloader brace. It is very effective in the early stages of unicompartmental knee osteoarthritis. So it works on a three-point pressure system. So it can either apply a varus or a valgus force at the knee joint. So it works on a push and pull mechanism. So the straps which you can see from here are pushing while the other two straps from this side are pulling. And this is now put for the medial compartment osteoarthritis. So it can either apply a varus or a valgus force and help to correct the knee osteoarthritis to some extent. So, and thus help in improving the quality of life of the patient in early stages of arthritis and aid in effective rehab. Stabilizing ligament knee brace. It is most commonly used in the ligament injuries, either preoperatively during the rehab or postoperatively. It can also help for the conservative management of the ligament sprains or strains. It acts as a prophylactic treatment, providing an extra stability to the knee till the time we achieve good balance, strength, and proprioception. Now we'll start knee, ankle, foot orthosis. It is the orthosis which will control foot, ankle and knee. It is used in the instability conditions of the knee, foot, ankle and giving the lower limb a proper alignment and a controlled motion. It can be used in various cases such as fractures, arthritic joints, hyperextension of the knee, weakness or even the paraparesis. So the types of KAFO are a double upright KFO or a single upright KFO. So these are the uprights. So it can either be a double upright or it can be a single upright. It can be a total contact KFO or an ischial weight bearing KFO. So grossly, the KFO consists of a thigh shell, the knee joint and the AFO component. AFO component can be static or dynamic. Knee component, we have multiple knee joints available. So this is a drop lock knee joint. There are even semi-automatic and automatic knee joints available. And these are the two uprights which control the motion. Total contact KFO comes in anterior posterior shell, which controls the entire limb and also comes with the drop lock knee joint. Ischial weight bearing caliper extends till the pelvic area. So in the patients where we want to offload the knee and the ankle, then we shift the entire weight on the ischium, and that is the reason it is called as ischial weight bearing KFO. Next is hip, knee, ankle, foot orthosis. So this is a custom made orthosis which involves the pelvic band, the knee joint, the thigh component, knee component and the AFO component. So the pelvic component can also be extended till the trunk depending upon the requirement of the patient. It helps to improve the alignment of the body and the posture, assist the weak muscles and help in giving us more efficient gait pattern. So the types of HKAFO are a basic HKAFO with a pelvic band, HKFO with the trunk extension. Now this depends upon the level of the injury in cases of spinal cord injuries or traumatic brain injury. So on the basis of the level and the weakness of the muscles, the prescription is to be given accordingly. Reciprocating gait orthosis is one of the type which is most commonly used in the cases of spina bifida or spinal cord injury, especially in kids with paraplegia. So it consists of the HKFO part and also a thoracic extension. So in RGO, the knee component and the ankle component are fixed, and the hip and the pelvic component will give you the motion and the pelvic rotation. So it has a cable attached. The cable is used to give the flexion on one side of the hip and the extension on the contralateral side of the hip, and thus help the patient to walk. The load bearing is also on the assistive aid of the patient, which the patient is using. Next is the hip orthosis. It consists of, again, the hip portion, the pelvic control and the thigh band. It provides stability to the pelvis and the hip joint in sitting, standing and in lying down position. It can be used in various cases of hip fractures, hip dislocation. Post-operatively, it can be used even in some congenital and developmental dysplasias of the hip. So the type of hip orthosis are the hip stabilizer brace, hip abduction brace, maple leaf brace, swash, which is called as standing, walking and sitting orthosis, and a rhino brace. So a hip stabilizer brace is most commonly used for immobilization post-operatively. It can either be in the surgical cases like total hip arthroplasty, or it could be any hip fracture. Post reduction for the dislocated hip for immobilization, it is most commonly used. It helps to restrict certain degrees of movement, and that is how it helps to heal post operatively. The other type is the hip abduction brace. It is used following the total hip replacement or post hip dislocation, it prevents excessive hip flexion and limits the adduction, and that's how it helps in healing post operatively. Maple leaf brace, this is specifically designed for the kids with cerebral palsy, so it can help to prevent the contractures of the muscles and the tightness. It can either consist of the calf component or it can be without the calf component, but it will definitely come with the pelvic and the thigh component. It can be used as an alternative to the traditional hip spica to maintain the length of the muscle post soft tissue release and give patients a stable base of support in sitting. Next is standing, walking and sitting orthosis, which is popularly called as SWASH. It helps to stabilize the hip and prevents the adduction of the limbs and the internal rotation. In short, it prevents the scissoring gait pattern, which we see in the CP cases. So it moves the hip into flexion, but it does not allow the hip to go into adduction and internal rotation. It helps to maintain it into abduction. Improves balance and stability, and especially used in children with CP. Rhino brace, it is used in the treatment of DDH. So in cases of DDH, in first 6 months, either a pollic harness can be given, or later after the reduction is done in dysplastic hips, hip abduction brace, which is also called as a rhino brace, is given to maintain the hip into the position and helps in healing and prevents further dislocation kids. So to conclude, multiple types of customized and new orthoses can also be fabricated as per the requirement of the patient, but it to improve the function and the quality of life. But the success of this orthosis is dependent upon the of the patient and the particular goals which we are designing for the patients by the physical therapist. Thank you.
Thank you so much, ma'am. It was a wonderful session. And you have almost covered all the useful, important and commonly used orthoses. Ma'am, we also have few questions from our viewers. So can we go
yes.
to the question answer session?
Yeah. Yeah, sure.
So ma'am, you talked about all these orthoses. So does every patient need customized okay. orthoses?
Well, that actually completely depends upon the impairments of the patient and the functional outcome which we are trying to achieve. So, for example, if it is a case of paraparesis or a child with cerebral palsy, so in that, if you have to give AFO or KFO, that needs to be customized as per the requirement, the impairment and the outcome the physical therapist is looking for from that patient. But if it is just the hip abduction brace or just a knee immobilizer or stabilizer, it can be just made into the universal sizes which are readily available. But in specific complex cases or the neurological cases, it is always better to get the orthosis customized to the patients to get a better outcome from them.
Are these customized orthoses are cost effective?
Yes, they can be made cost effective depending upon the requirement. So, for example, a simple AFO, a dynamic AFO can range from a basic joint to a well-fabricated imported joint. So, depending upon the affordability of the patient, we can always work out with the prosthetist and orthotist to make a affordable customized orthosis for the patient. So, that is definitely possible.
So, ma'am, you also talked about the flat foot, right? So, the insoles and insoles required for flat foot. So I was asking about, you talked about insoles for flat foot and all. So does every flat foot require correction? Like it is very commonly seen now.
Okay. Yes, that is a very good question. Actually, honestly speaking, from my personal experience, yes, every flat foot needs a correction. But there are different types. So either it could be a dynamic or a flexible flat foot, or it could be a structural flat foot. Now, I have seen patients who come with symptoms and who there are patients who do not have symptoms at all, and they come at the age of 60s or 70s when they start experiencing little bit of pain in the ankles and the knees. But if diagnosed at early stages and if the alignment is corrected at the early stage, it is always better to protect the joints like knee and hip, which are indirectly going to get affected because of the alignment changes or the issues in the foot. So even if symptomatic or non-symptomatic, I would always prefer any of the flat foot or the high arch foot to be corrected.
So after prescribing them, or for that matter, any orthosis, do we have to again check the body alignment?
Yes, actually, especially it could be with not only with the insoles, it could be with all the types of the lower limb orthosis, especially that once the fitment is done, you should actually check the alignment of the body. If possible, check the gait, the outcomes which we were trying to achieve. Are we achieving? Need any specific corrections to be made? So if it is a AFO, KFO or HKFO, I normally assess the gait pattern of the patient. If all movements are possible, if there are any trick movements happening, and if that requires any change. And in terms of insoles, if you ask me, so I make sure that the digital scan is done pre-insole and post-insole to check if there is any alignment change or if it needs to be corrected even further. The most important part of the checking is a regular follow-up. So I always ask my patients to follow up at least after 3 to 4 weeks to check if the orthosis is working well for them.
Okay, so we give them time to get adapted to the orthosis, and then...
Yeah, they need some time.
So yeah, in case yes, it is not exactly fitting them, you again modify the orthosis?
If it is not fitting well, or if it is not giving us a certain amount of correction in a designated period of time, so yes, it does need minor correction. Even patients will come back to you with slight amount of discomfort. It could be just a fitting issue, or it could be any specific correction, but yes, follow-up is the key to any successful orthosis.
Yes. And how much time should we be giving them to get adapted to the orthosis?
So in cases of insoles, I at least ask them to use it for 3 to 4 weeks. Even if they have any discomfort or no, I ask them to follow up with me after a month. And if any other discomfort arises before that, any pain which is unbearable, I ask them to follow up immediately. But I think for insoles, 3 to 4 weeks time is sufficient. And for other orthosis, lower limb orthosis, I think a week or two time is sufficient to understand. And even the treating therapist will also come up to us with certain amount of changes. So a follow-up with the treating therapist as well as with the prosthetist, orthotist and the rehab therapist is equally important.
And how do you ensure the correct fitting in, especially in PEDS?
Yes. So correct orthotic fitting does not always mean if the orthosis is tight or loose. The correct orthosis fitment, especially in kids where they will not be able to tell you exactly what is happening to them. So in that, first thing is the checking of the the alignment, the angles which we need, whether the given orthosis is satisfying all the angles and the corrections which we wanted to make, whether the orthosis is too tight or too loose. Educating the parents regarding the wearing time of the orthosis, also actually it needs the thorough assessment of the patient again, that the reason for which we gave the orthosis, is it helping it, or we need to do some specific changes into it, because after application we might have to give second thought at times, that is it properly helping the patient, or we need to add few more things into it. And that is why I always put pressure on giving a good customized orthosis to kids, because each and every kid will come with a different set of problems.
And parents role
and parents would not understand. So educating the parents, referring it back to the therapist again to get it cross-checked is always important.
Yes. And ma'am, what is your opinion about orthotic dependency?
Yes. So orthotic dependency actually would not, it would not apply to all the patients, I feel, because for a CP kid or a spastic die kid or a patient with paraparesis, we'll have to use an AFO or a KFO for the efficient gait, for walking, for propulsion. So in them, along with rehabilitation, so it acts like an adjunct to the rehabilitation. So with exercises and physiotherapy, this will give you an add-on effect, which will give us more efficient gait pattern, improve function and the quality of life of the patient. So in them, we would not talk about the orthosis dependency, but I think the orthosis dependency would more come into picture when it comes to the knee braces, especially used post-operatively. So it could be like a stability brace, which is just given for the immobilization, or it could be an ROM brace to restrict certain amount of motion in patient. So I believe that to prevent this dependency, the operating surgeon and the physical therapist have to decide a particular time where we have to advise the patient to wean off from that brace. The moment we know that the patient has started developing that dependency, and even though we are training for strength and balance and proprioception and it is not helping, is the time you know that the patient has become dependent on. Type or designated time period. It will be dependent upon the patient and the case, and also upon the operating surgeon and the physical therapist treating the patient.
Yeah. So reassessment we should be doing, and patient strength and overall.
Yes, yes. So reassessing, exactly. Okay. Overall, yes, absolutely.
Thank you so much, ma'am. That's all from our side. The questions are, thank you so much for your time, and we also thank Physio TV for giving
this
learning opportunity regarding these gray area of orthotics and prosthetics. Thank you once again, and we'll see you in the next part where we'll be covering orthotics of upper limb. Okay.
Thank you.